Welcome to the Green Ring, and thanks for watching. This video is 12th in a series of 21 which present a note-by-note analysis of Wagner's Die Walküre, Act 2. Built on nearly two centuries of scholarly literature, this massive journey aspires to examine in its entirety Der Ring des Nibelungen to its final note. I hope you'll take this gigantic voyage with me, which I'm working night and day to complete. For an explanation of who I am and more on the reasons for this series, please check out my preface video. Its link is supplied below, along with those for the videos beginning each Das Rheingold scene and Die Walküre Act 1. Before diving into this video, you may want to watch the case for Erda, the case against Photon, and the case for Loge, which present my views on how and why Wagner manipulates his musical syntax as he does, in the process identifying key morphemes which I believe define the entire work. You'll find explanations for why the terms leitmotif, motif, and motive have been replaced by morpheme, module, and cell in the chapter titled Music as Text. Links are provided in the comments below. We pick up with the third stave of page 264 in Dover's full score as the Valkyrie intuits Photon means to abandon Siegmund. Key change to ominous C minor, darkening of Photon's hopeful C major, timpani roll octavo tuba pedal supports contrabasses in the first of two revolt strophes, if only its initial eight notes without triplet. At a crotchet delay from the downbeat, Brunhilde voices this, her worst fear, atop its leading pulse, her static notes moving to retrograde chord notes and Welsung joy, contrabasses freezing tremolo with its downbeat to foreshadow a return of Wotan's earlier tirade, cello's violas taking the next revolt iteration with her Welsung triad's third beat. Wotan's new tantrum unfolds rather differently this time, as timpani break off with revolt's terminal downbeat, tuba pedal continued, tremolo contrabasses sinking through a ring fragment's initial triad. Woodwind horn minim doubling anticipates it by an upbeat crotchet to dovetail the morpheme after a single Welterb triad into retrograde melody notes, a combination immediately repeated a third above, woodwind strengthened. This eerie descant of Albrecht's Rheingold escape, here as there, each time rounds in retrograde ring fragments, here viola cello semiquaver flag quavers. Wotan resumes on the heels of the Valkyrie's final minim to agonize over having touched ring and hoard, intoning two conjoined static ash intervals, followed by ring lust on Albrecht's ring. Resting a minim, he continues parsing the Welterb triad's first two pitches through a baleful inverted ash interval to finish on yet another ringless pulse, this one heavily distorted by rising a minor seventh, Erda stabbing his conscience. Woodwind's horns respond with two powerful conjoined ringlust iterations, ascending harmonically as viola's cellos descend tremolo through still another ring fragment. Then, timpani roll relaunched atop continued tuba pedal and low strings viola second violin tremolos, horns woodwinds bellow a pair of Welsung love strophes, doubled by first violin tremolo almost exactly as in the god's earlier paroxysm, yet another unnerving echo of Albrecht's ring plight. With them, Warfather voices his most self-aware comment to date. Der Fluch, den ich floh, nicht flieht nun mich. Set first to a distorted ringlust module, then, separated by his crotchet quaver rest, its reversal. The primary love morpheme is here deliberately ironic, the god too full of himself to consider his Valkyrie child's distress, never mind that of his Welsungs. The contrasting attitudes of father and daughter speak volumes about the pledge to Erda his divine child represents. Brunhilde's only thought is for her father's anguish over the doomed hero, while Wotan is troubled only by disposal of Siegmund, ruining his plans and bruising his ego. The Welsung is now merely a lost plaything, and Brunhilde's ever more fervently empathetic appeals on Siegmund's behalf evoke not so much as a word from the god about his son's actual plight. No friend to genuine empathetic love, he only grows angrier, his remarks ever more selfishly arrogant. Cook's old Wotan dwells on his own prideful schemes alone, and his next still more revealing outburst throws a harsh light on the emotional link between Warfather and his Nibelung foes. Despite painfully dissonant harmonic complexity, this passage's syntax is limpid. Each of three brass woodwind modular bundles launch on ash intervals in purest rising octave form. Their progressive reinforcements, doubled in upper string tremolos, repeat the same morphemic quartet of retrograde melody notes and opposing tremolo cello melody notes. In short, the horde set against Wotan's racial hope. With low string doubling, these lead to high ash intervals, lifting rather weakly on major seconds into the infamous double impact. Alone among commentators cited in this analysis, Sabor notes the passage's obvious evolution of renunciation, albeit confusing it with its later resignation variant. The irony of this syntax, combined with the god's words, strikes to the core of that self-deception pervading Wotan's monologue. He claims to sorrow over his murderous betrayal of Siegmund, the son he claims to love, when he really bewails loss of world power stolen from the primeval ash. Like Alberich, he has renounced love to attain his mighty station. Now his ploy has soured, just as it has for the dwarf, Warfather can think of Siegmund's loss only as it affects himself. To underline this blatant narcissism, his vocal is unusually syntax-light, two static ash intervals and a feeble low ash interval, both phrases capped with descending sixths as poor echoes of his previous despair. It's enlightening to compare this episode with what may be considered its precursor, that moment in Act I when Sieglinde's dawning recognition of her blood bond with Siegmund floods over her. Distinctive pure ash intervals link the two passages as they announce tellingly different morphemes. In the Welsung's case, their ash intervals sound their purest long-short-long syncopation, followed by the core love module. For Wotan, the ash intervals are denatured of those syncopations, denoting a key aspect of their power, the following morpheme here not love but renunciation. By welcoming their empathetic bond, the Welsungs have a legitimate shot at nature's regenerative powers. Conversely, by rejecting love in favor of world control, the Welsungs' life force evades the god. Despite the monologue's escalating despair, Warfather remains committed to holding his grip on creation, a point reinforced over the next measures. Warfather continues through a slow, spear-like descent launched by a plunging minor third. Second horn first tenor tuba double his initial three notes, lower tubas joining low woodwinds in a breve chord extended through the next measure. It's difficult to miss the flavor of resignation in the god's vocal, its third measure downbeat tapped by staccato strings, horn woodwind chord ended on a crotchet. This leaves timpani roll alone to swell hideously beneath three unison trombones as they intone the curse. Missing only its coda, this horrific morpheme sounds exactly as it does for the first time in Rheingold. There, however, the ghastly morpheme sounds twice, the second time also lacking its coda built from erta chords and intertwined retrograde melody notes. This analysis posits that first Rheingold iteration denotes the giants, both the dead Fasolt and his surviving murderer Fafnir, while its immediately following second pulse connotes the god's overarching liability. The present curse iteration seems to ratify that conclusion, eliciting from the god a volcanic reaction launched on a swift climax. As with many such instances, the passage boils down to a handful of repeated modules. Violas replaced in the third measure by violins carry its deep syntactic message through a defiant series of rising-falling sine waves, launched in up-down bounces, followed by swift plunging arpeggios. These initiate in putative C major mode, the key of Wotan's hopes, conforming to a broad octavo first bass trumpet sort iteration. The bounces conform to their harmonic setting, thus alternate predominant Velsung thirds associated with mortal vitality, as in Wotan's inspiration and the sort Notong, with a pair of fourth cells, meaning the Wöthing bounce. Warfather's mind is firmly on his endangered plan for slaying Fafnir, even as he despairs of Siegmund. With the sword's heroic melody notes in the third measure, tubas growl the curse coda, even if rather tardily, retrograde melody notes intact, shifting the passage to a threatening diminished C minor seventh harmony, as if to checkmate the sword. String modules following arpeggios eerily like ring fragments thanks to the harmonic shift to diminished minor sevenths. Warfather's curse has at last come home to roost. One feels bound, if only reluctantly, to classify the sequence's arpeggio modules as bona fide recurring syntax and name that morpheme racial fury, since it has powerful roots, first in Albrecht's vehement Rheingold defense of his claims to the ring, whose initial appearance includes a third bounce. While that element disappears from later iterations, meaning the dwarf's last plea against Wotan and Albrecht's hysterical retreat after losing his ring, this plunging arpeggio module goes on to serve analogous functions in Siegfried. Its basis in the ring fragment gives it special weight, a resemblance which becomes overt once the curse coda supplants that module for what, during the major mode sword iterations, have been Velsung triads and retrograde heroic melody note strophes. This is the crux of Wotan's dilemma. His plan for racial hegemony, along with continued power over Erda's natural world, shattered by loss of his Velsung hero. Overlapping contrabass giant thump static ash intervals on G-flat give even the sword iteration a minor mode twinge, a kind of heartbeat throughout the passage's first five measures, which disappears in a retrograde ash interval through chord notes as Wotan rejoins the ensemble with a distorted low interval through which he lifts a third into the passage's extended climactic roar. Contrabasses lift Erda-like, while violins expand the prior modules by ascending a sixth, then plunging through a noble if shattered major mode arpeggio. This confirms the god's ultimately more honorable intentions, despite his many dishonorable actions, distancing itself from the ring fragment originally giving birth to this syntax, thus underlining the contrast between the god's racial program and that of giant Nibelungs. Even so, it swerves back towards those diminished minor seventh harmonies as its final three pitches outline retrograde melody notes, Warfather still committed to his Velsung scheme, if only deep in his subconscious. Per stage directions accompanying this passage, Wotan's Gebärde gibt aus dem Ausdruck dem furchtbarsten Schmerzes zu dem Verschweiflung über. If, as most analyses claim, Wotan's monologue represents a complete loss of hope, this outburst suggests he's still fighting. Merriam-Webster defines despair as a state of hopelessness leading to rashness. This latest outburst is certainly that, Wotan voicing a series of cries for the destruction of all he's built, what seems to him the only active step he can now take. Looking first at his vocal, he continues with a pure anti-barrier, then, after a crotchet rest on the words, Göttliches Prunkus, Erda melody notes terminated by a plunging octave, which he immediately tops with another anti-barrier, this one distorted by rising a wild seventh. Each of these phrases alternate with violin evolutions of racial fury, their double impacts echoing Fricka's challenge. These resemble world ash intervals striving for their purest version, the second rising a heroic fifth, the third almost succeeding in that it lifts a desperate octave only to be defeated by the fourth stroke's return to that initial sixth, an interval ultimately destined to provide one of the epic's most potent syntactic messages, and in the precise context of this despairing Valkyrie passage. Yet none of these four modules attain to either a world ash interval or the Velsung third bounce. As such, they instead mark the god's decaying power. These foreground cells are left as deliberately free as possible of Votan's vocal, so both may be more clearly heard. Yet supporting semi-brevi chords, woodwind slow brass alternating with horns, tremolo viola cello chording throughout progress relentlessly from defiant noble major into a potently despairing diminished minor seventh flavor. Audiences likely grasp nothing from this tumult except Votan's mounting self-revulsion, but closer examination also uncovers in these seven measures a harmonic presentiment of the god's Siegfried wanderer persona. Whether this is an intentional parallel or one of those unconscious tics at which Newman sniffed, its timing is strikingly apt. This analysis maintains the god's present rage signals defiance against his potential defeat. The surest narrative validation of that contention is Warfather's presence in Siegfried, his activities there giving the lie to tradition's belief he's transformed in some fundamental way, an argument which must await the epic's third chapter, where he presents himself as the Wanderer. Votan's fury continues to mount as violins conclude their fourth and final arpeggio in a kind of trill appoggiatura, its four demi-semi quavers rushing up to launch the next measure on a quaver. Timpani roll initiated beneath low woodwind cording. This is only the briefest hint the god's sensual vitality hasn't yet been trampled, since it's not heard again as violins progress through a quartet of measures, each extending their scalar ascents through septuplets into next downbeat's quavers. With the second of these, and repeated through the climactic build in the next two, second-third trumpets pulse those octavo Valhalla ash intervals threatening Siegmund as he enters the scene in Act One. Amid this wild escalation, Votan's vocal leaps up a sixth into a ringlust retrograde to extend through an elongated distortion of the module proper, which, after a minim rest, he repeats, lifted with the harmony. Violins initiate their last upward racing scale, while second-third trumpets round their Valhalla ash interval with the broad static ash interval. Ended with the next downbeat, it joins a semi-breve crotchet chord across woodwinds, brass, tremolo low strings, as violins freeze on a minim at the top of their arc to plunge through an extended racial fury arpeggio evocative of Albach's furious exit after losing his ring. With this bundle, first timpani rolled handed to second for the harmonic change, Votan howls he wants one thing only. His Velsung third bounces, middle high F natural, held a fiery semi-quaver minim. Woodwinds, viola, cello, tremolos, painful diminished minor seventh chord flickers out on the next downbeat's crotchet, leaving only bassoon's horns to fade as with the following downbeat he sinks through a Velsung triad, then extends it into a bona fide ring fragment, its second triad a cappella, bassoon horn chord having released on its downbeat. A semi-breve of full vocal orchestral silence follows his terminal crotchet F natural to prepare a moment which, despite controversy, is justly famed. This passage of syntax is comparatively simple, which only heightens its eloquence. The god's two howls for self-annihilation begin on rising fourths and conclude with horrific plunging octaves. The first thunderous, the second muted, the two cries separated by a fermata on the intervening crotchet rest, which mottles directions added to the Dover score in struct should be Lange. This explosion of nihilism can't help but terrify Brunhilde to the limit of her endurance, though most directors apparently instruct their Valkyries to minimize their reactions in deference to Wotan as the center of attention. Most are content for him to sing these cries center stage and immobile, but there are a few exceptions. On his first exclamation, Shiro's Wotan yanks to a standstill the large pendulum which has been circling continuously from act's beginning, while the shout of Kupfer's Lysir Immortal brings a set piece crashing down behind him, which some might find shocking and others comical. Copenhagen's god smashing a tombstone-like ceramic to the floor. Yet their Brunhildes do little more than gawk. Abate opines, "Her presence and identity as a listener, however, is in fact extremely complex, a focus of moral acuity and tragic skepticism." Part of her thesis, the monologue illustrates an internal conflict between words and music, and her analysis of this passage inadvertently produces a keen insight. Disinterested in its syntax, she instead concentrates on its harmonic design, which she describes as a repeated succession of discontinuous chords. She means the god's first E major cry shifting to a second in C minor, then his subsequent A flat minor phrase. This progression certainly defies any cadence known to harmonic practice up to that time, a detail Abate lingers over to support her premise the monologue is a series of conceptual disconnects. Herein lies the drawback of ignoring the work's developing syntax. Each of these harmonic shifts take place in conjunction with the god's three consecutive plunging octaves, the Meister's standard practice to root in audience's mind particularly important syntactic bundles by repeating them raised a harmonic third. Here, by instead sinking in thirds, these octaves produce that sharp emotional dislocation most appropriate to the threatening horror of Wotan's poetic text. An equally striking morphemic signal lurks in this harmonic progression, as Warfather's trio of falling octaves outline a Welterb triad, that same module now attached to his Velsungs, which plays so crucial a role in everything leading to this high point of Wotan's despair. What the god laments before all else, what he now believes utterly crushed, is the racial solution he first envisions in Rheingold, ever since devoting his whole attention to it. This sequence, therefore, progresses on the spot into a contemplation of Albrecht's racial program, one the god now believes marches on unimpeded thanks to the collapse of his own. Abate's striking insight thus points ahead to Götterdämmerung, where that threat bears its fangs, a detail which must wait for the epic's final chapter. Trombones, violas, cellos answer Wotan, breathing Erda's morpheme, atop whose final note, sustained by trombones, the god mutters, "Und für das Ende sorgt Albrecht." Beginning on Erda melody notes to drop a third for a weak chagrin pulse. This also initiates an unnerving crib on that heroic cell born of Donner's Rheingold vocal, which has since definitively solidified into the Valkyrie tattoo, its constituent cells an inversion of Wotan's inspirational third bounce, as in both Donner's and the Valkyrie's modules, their abandonment triads replaced with first inversion heroic melody notes. Wotan sings the dwarf's name aptly enough through the direst of inverted ash intervals on his last falling octave, that which completes the Welterb triad outlined by harmonic shifts and specifically marked in the god's vocal octave trio. With it, violins, violas, doubled in ominous bassoon trumpets, repeat Erda over timpani roll and trombone tuba-dotted semibreve chord, one of those many subtleties of orchestration which give the ring its unique sonic flavor. Only now does Wotan at last share with his beleaguered daughter that additional news given him by the Vala, what he's earlier hinted as the font of suicidal worries which, per this analysis, goads Warfather's breeding program, his design for altering the world's mortal populations in his favor. Though bereft of the ring's power, Alberich has managed to bribe a mortal woman into bearing his child, a revelation which at last explains Wotan's monumental despair. Phrasing his reveal as he does, "Jetzt verstehe ich den stummen Sinn des wilden Wortes der Valar," suggests his ironclad faith that Siegmund would get the ring for him, so render Hagen moot. In turn, this implies the moment he heard it, he understood what the news of a dwarf son could mean to his hegemony, and given the tasks he sets the Valkyries and Velsungs, it seems yet another instance of the immortal lying to himself and Brunhilde. He introduces this eye-opener as the second gradually fading Erda pulse, with each choir abandoning their pedal point to leave his concluding notes a cappella, a wulfing bounce, static notes, retrograde melody notes, a low ash interval, and chagrin finish, plunging a sixth. He repeats Erda's prediction, quote marks to suggest he does so verbatim, atop a string of 8 resentment pulses, scored as the morpheme first sounds in Rheingold and through the same menacing harmonic ascent. World ash intervals dominate his vocal, almost entirely parsed as 3 phrases, separated by 2 dotted crotchet rests, the first a static interval duo, capped by a low, rising a third, the second a static capped with an embryonic fate pulse. The god's last phrase, as he repeats how this birth threatens the god's end, forms a despairing arch, low ash interval elided to a pair of retrogrades, and all on intervals of a third, making the whole an abandonment triad answered by its Welt Erba Velsung counterpart, almost an Erda Twilight echo. The ominous sequence capped by cellos opposing resentment's rising grace in rising contrabasses. Their flourish announces a new composite morpheme with a baleful, horrific sense of godly doom. This transformation is one of only 2 mysteries Wagner himself ever clarified in the very little he wrote about his syntactic technique, though he deliberately left vague its relationship to his overall syntactic method.
Bors and Wotan's words, this tone figure should give us a picture of the fearful gloom in the soul of the suffering god.
Built from 2 morphemes, low woodwind horns Valhalla Part 1, sandwiched into bass trumpets Rheingold Tattoo, its jarring dissonances evoke Valhalla's grandeur shattered under the heel of Alberich's Rheingold-begotten power. While depicting the gloom at the core of Wotan's soul, the syntax conveys a deeper message as well, by phrasing its initial notes as that double impact in Fricka's version of the barrier, slowed to reflect Hunding's syntax. The added Valhalla Ash interval, with its established threat to Siegmund, juxtaposes a second and third double impact ratified in the continuing Valhalla module by the Rheingold cell's initial impacts, to be finished on its wonted abandonment triad. Erda's vengeance, her Rheingold lure, conspires with God's consort, the dwarf, and the newly conceived mortal destined to exterminate Warfather's longed-for hero. The Vala stands aloof, Albrecht and his son unopposed, as they establish a world of perverted nature atop the ruins of that which the god believes the better of the two, a turn of events Fricka's triumph now makes inevitable. As a cap, one idea lies at this bundle's core, a thought which consumes Wotan's attentions long before he hatches his Velsung scheme, a high ash interval which this distortion opposes with a harsh inverted, to evoke the immortals' long-ago Valhalla inspiration thanks to sight of the world ash. On a more subtle note, first horn opposes Erda melody notes with bass trumpets retrogrades. Despite the Meister's attention to this syntax, the analytic tradition's interest is spotty. Volzogen notes its unique phrasing, though his example cites not the initial pulse but its next, while Kobe pays it no mind. Neumann, who cites its first iteration, notes it only as a
somber mutation.
Following Volzogen's lead, Hutchison cites its second iteration, calling it a
gruesome perversion
of the Valhalla Rhyme Code syntax, which it certainly is, then says no more. Cook's limited analysis doesn't mention it, and since it lies beyond the analytic purview of both Dunnington and Holman, they make no comment. Spencer Millington and Sabor recognize its constituent elements, but say nothing about its narrative weight. A brief three-measure respite abandons resentment as bass trumpet's final B-flat lingers alone through a semibrivic quaver, while the god announces he's heard news of Hagen's conception. His vocal takes a third bounce to sink through a Velsung triad into a dire inverted ash interval, followed by chagrin. Viola cello tremolo creeps in and swells as he embellishes another third bounce with a retrograde ash interval, leaping up a seventh from his following Velsung triad into chord notes. After a quaver rest, he bounces up a third from two static E-flats into an anti-barrier on a sixth, thus launching another orchestral resentment meditation half so long as the previous. Its first resentment iteration consists of pulses alone, while the next four sound with their wonted viola graces, horn punches extending their semibrevi minims into the second of each pulsation duo, where they lapse on quavers. Atop a freer harmonic ascent, Votan intones a pair of mirroring lines begun on pathetic downward sixth and third lists, essentially ring-lust retrogrades, each tailed into extended retrograde melody notes parsed as initial crotchets, followed by long, short, long pulses to emphasize their retrograde melody note quality. These two succinct bundles, his despair both of the Nibelung sun and his own, support his description of Hagen's conception in unusually graphic language. Des Hasses Frucht heckt eine Frau, des Neides Kraft kriegst ihren Schuss. A strong hint Siegfried and Hagen are of the same age, especially as Act 3 reveals Sieglinde is also pregnant. While the god's syntax expresses how this Nibelung mortal blights his hope for seizing back the ring, and along with any demigod grandchildren Warfather might have enjoyed. Votan concludes his tortured meditation on Hagen's birth by comparing Alberich's loveless success with what he characterizes as his failure through love, another self-deception given he fatally neglects his purported love object, possibly even by design. Alberich's dark achievement inspires a horn, woodwind, viola, cello resignation strophe in much the same form it takes during the earlier part of the god's monologue, here prefaced by cello's pure ash interval as grafted to its distortion minutes before. Warfather leads to it with a third lift and aired chord notes, rises a tritone into retrograde melody notes, and inverted ash interval, to end by sinking through what will come to be known as the Hagen tritone. First violins race down demi-semi-quavers into Votan's lament over his failure to equal Albrecht's fertility, atop a heart-rending progression of minim string chords, their only syntax first violin's fourth ascent into retrograde melody notes. The immortal roughly doubles this line, parsing the melody notes as a baleful inverted ash interval to conclude after a quaver rest, lifting bitterly on retrograde chord notes into a fourth descent. A second quaver rest, tapped by loud string quaver chords, separates his ascent of a fourth, high A-flat, stressed by a second quieter string quaver, as he finishes with chord notes through another inverted ash interval and doomed plunging fifth. The immortal's wording betrays how far he's deluded himself. Doch der in Liebe ich freite, den Frieden erlang ich mir nicht. This claim shows Votan still blind to the reality of empathetic love, interested in the Velsung dam for little more than her womb, a brute tool with which he may gestate a hero to solve his ring woes. Alberich does exactly the same in fathering Hagen, neither cases of love but rather cold-blooded exploitation. Votan cannot and will not see the full truth until, as Wagner put it to Rilke, the very end. It isn't the Nibelung who dooms Warfather so much as his own misguided vision of the natural world and his place in it. If Erda is to transform Vulkan's rape of her creation into something positive, she must radically alter his mindset. She must teach him love. His monologue proves that lesson can only come at a fearsome price. The god is unable to begin that journey of discovery in earnest until he loses not only his Velsungs, but his beloved daughter into the bargain. That's a wrap for this video. The next commences where it leaves off, page 278 in Dovre's full score, as Votan deeds his worldly power to the unborn Hagen. As always, thanks for watching, and please do leave your comments. Time and energy allowing, I'll do everything I can to respond. Lastly, as all YouTubers know, your subscription to this channel by itself is a huge assist in completing this vast project. Hit the bell to be notified of the next videos. With luck and your support, there's a lot more to come.